everyone, I'm Akanksha Sharma and you are watching your channel English Only Zone. Today we'll study a beautiful poem, The Solitary Reaper, which is written by a very famous poet, William Wordsworth. Before starting the poem, I would like to request you to watch full video because you will be able to understand this beautiful poem only if you watch this full video. Also, if you want to understand this poem in Hindi, don't forget to subscribe the channel and to click on the bell icon, because if you click on the bell icon, then only you will be able to get the notification of new videos. So, just subscribe the channel and click on the bell icon. So, let's study the introduction of the poem first. William Wordsworth was a poet of Romantic age. Like I told you earlier also in my previous videos, we have different ages in English literature, like Shakespearean age, Romantic age, Elizabethan age, etc. So William Wordsworth was actually the pioneer of Romantic age. He, along with S.T. Coleridge, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, started this Romantic age by writing beautiful ballads. Now, what is a ballad? That we will be studying on the next page. He is known as a great lover and preacher of nature. So most of his poems contains the element of nature. The poem, The Solitary Reaper, gives us the view of beautiful highlands of Scotland. Scotland was divided into lowlands and highlands. So this highland is a highland not only from geographical point of view, but also from cultural point of view. So Scotland is a beautiful country, small country, which is divided into lowlands and highlands. And this poem is based on the highlands of Scotland. The next point is, the poet passes from a highland area where he sees a Scottish girl, means a girl from Scotland, reaping her crops. Reaping means cutting. The girl is singing and reaping the crops. The song seems to be a sad one and the poet is not able to understand the language of the song. The song which the girl was singing was a sad song and the poet was also not able to understand the language of the song. But still, he listens to the song and then continues his journey. So, this was the introduction of the poem. Let's understand the form of the poem. As I told you, this poem is a ballad. Now, what is a ballad? A ballad is a long song or poem that tells us a story. So, if you want to tell a story in the form of a song or a poem, then it means you are narrating a ballad. And there is no limitation of number of lines for a ballad. Like in sonnet, etc., in some forms of poem, we have some limitation of lines. But in ballad, there is no limitation of lines. The poet may extend it to any length. Okay? So this was all related to the starting of the poem, the introduction, the form. Now, one more important thing is the title of the song, of this poem. The title of this poem is The Solitary Reaper. So, what do you mean by the solitary reaper? Solitary means alone. And reaper means the person who cuts the crops, who reaps the crop. So, this poem is basically based on a girl who is alone in the field and cutting the crops. So, this was all about the title of the poem. Now, let's start the poem. This is your stanza one. Read this stanza along with me and then we will be discussing the meaning of few difficult words. Behold her singing in the field, yon solitary highland lass, reaping and singing by herself. Stop here or gently pass. Alone she cuts and binds the grain and sings a melancholy strain. Oh, listen, for the wail profound is overflowing with the sound. So this is a stanza one. Let's understand the meaning of difficult words. Behold. Behold means look. Look carefully. Next word is yon. Yon means that. Solitary means alone. Highland, as I told you, it's the Scotland is divided into highland and lowland. So this highland is actually a mountain area. Lass means girl. Reaping means cutting crops, that I told you. Binds means ties the grain. A melancholy strain, it means a sad song. Melancholy means sad and strain means song. The wail profound, it means full great valley. is overflowing with the sound, it means it's buzzing with the sound. So, let's understand this stanza. The poet says, "Behold her, single in the field. Look at her. Look carefully at this girl who is there in the field all alone. Yon solitary highland lass, that alone mountain girl. Look at the alone mountain girl there in the field. Reaping and singing by herself. The girl is reaping the crops and singing by herself. Stop here or gently pass." Now the poet is talking to his fellow travelers and he's saying, either you should stop here to listen the song or you gently pass away from there by not even disturbing the girl. Alone she cuts and binds the grain. The poet then says that the girl is cutting and binding the grain all alone and sings a melancholy strain. And while doing this work, she is singing a sad song. Oh, listen, for the wail profound is overflowing with the sound. And then the poet again talks to his fellow travelers and says that this full great valley is overflowing with the sound of the song of the girl. This full great valley is buzzing with the sound of the girl. Okay, now quickly revise what we have studied in this stanza. The poet is passing from the field, a highland of Scotland, and he saw a girl who was doing the work in the fields. What work she was doing? She was reaping the crops and tying them. And while doing her work, she was singing in the field. And it felt to the poet that the song was a sad song. And he says that this full great valley of Scotland was buzzing with the sound of the girl's song. I hope you have understood the first stanza. Now let's move on to the second stanza. No nightingale did ever chaunt more welcome notes to weary bands of travellers in some shady haunt among Arabian sands. A voice so thrilling ne'er was heard in springtime from the cuckoo bird, breaking the silence of the seas among the farthest Hebrides. Let's understand the meaning of difficult words of this stanza. Nightingale, it means a sweet voice bird, a bird which has a sweet voice. Let's see the picture of nightingale. This is how nightingale looks. And you know, one of our Indian poet is given the title of Nightingale of India. Who is that poet? Yes, Sarojini Naidu, Mrs. Sarojini Naidu. Now, chaunt means sing, weary means tired, haunt means place, Arabian sands means Arabian desert, thrilling means exciting, never means never, farthest Hebrides means far off islands of Scotland. There were some islands near Scotland, so the poet is talking about those islands. So let's understand this stanza. No nightingale did ever chaunt more welcome notes to weary bands of travellers in some shady haunt among Arabian sands. Now through these lines, the poet is trying to establish a comparison between the song of the Scottish girl and that of a nightingale. The poet says that when the travellers travel in the Arabian desert, and we know that Arabian desert is very vast, so when the travellers travel in Arabian desert, no nightingale has ever sung such a beautiful welcome song for those travellers when they sit in some shady place to rest. No nightingale has ever sung such a beautiful welcome song for those travellers who sit under some shady place to take some rest. The song of the girl is much more beautiful and soothing than that of a nightingale. The poet wanted to say that the song of the girl is much more soothing than the song of a nightingale when a nightingale sings for some tired travellers. Now, the poet writes, a voice so thrilling never was heard in springtime from the cuckoo bird, breaking the silence of the seas among the farthest Hebrides. Now, in these four lines, the poet is comparing the voice of the Scottish girl and the voice of a cuckoo bird. The poet says that such a beautiful and exciting voice is never heard from even a cuckoo bird during springtime. The voice of the girl is breaking the silence of the sea and is traveling to the far-off islands of Scotland. The voice of the girl is traveling far away to the far-off islands of Scotland. I hope you've understood this stanza. Now let's quickly revise what we have studied in this stanza. No nightingale did ever chaunt more welcome notes to weary bands. Here the poet wants to compare the song of the nightingale with the song of the girl. The poet says that the song of the girl is much more beautiful, relaxing, soothing as compared to the song of a nightingale. Then in the last four lines, the poet compares the song of the girl with the help of cuckoo bird. So again here the poet says the song of the girl is much more beautiful as compared to cuckoo bird when it sings during the spring season also. So this was all in the second stanza. Now let's come to third stanza. Will no one tell me what she sings? Perhaps the plaintive numbers flow for old unhappy far off things and battles long ago. Or is it some more humble lay, familiar matter of today, some natural sorrow, loss or pain that has been or may be again? Here the poet asks his fellow travellers that will no one tell him what the girl is singing, what song the girl is singing. He is asking that fellow travellers that can anyone tell him what song the girl is singing. Now he is answering his question himself. What he is answering? Perhaps the plaintive numbers flow for old unhappy far off things. The poet gives the answer to his question himself and he says, perhaps the girl is singing about some plaintive number. Now plaintive number means sad song. Okay? Plaintive number means a sad song. The poet says, the girl must be singing some sad song for old unhappy far off things. The girl must be singing the song for some old things, unhappy things, which happened far off years ago and battles long ago. And then he says, maybe the girl is singing about some battles which were held long ago. Or is it some more humble lay, familiar matter of today? And then the poet says, is it some more humble lay? Humble lay means humble song, familiar matter of today, related to the day-to-day life of the girl. The poet says, maybe the girl is singing a song which is related to the day-to-day life of the girl herself. Some natural sorrow, loss or pain that has been and may be again. Maybe the girl is singing about some natural sorrow, some loss or some pain that has been, that was there with the girl, or it may occur again. Maybe again means it may occur again. So what we have studied in this third stanza, for the stanza starts with a question. The poet is asking a question, will no one tell me what song the girl is singing? And then he gives the answer himself. He says, perhaps the girl is singing a sad song related to some old, unhappy, far-off things. And maybe the song is related to some battles which were fought long ago. And then he says, or is it some more humble lay, familiar matter of today? The poet then asks that is the song related to the day-to-day life of the girl? Is it related to some natural sorrow, loss or pain which the girl had observed, which the girl had felt in her life that she has felt or maybe it happened again? The same natural loss, sorrow or pain maybe that may happen again. So the girl is singing about all those unhappy things. So this stanza basically tells us that the song was actually a sad one, and so the poet has given so many options that it may be related to some old unhappy far off things, it may be related to battles, it may be related to some familiar matter of the girl, day-to-day life of the girl, it may be related to some natural sorrow, loss or pain that was there with the girl, or it may happen again. Okay? Now let's come to the last stanza of this poem. Whatever the theme, the maiden sang, as if her song could have no ending. I saw her singing at her work and over the sickle bending. I listened motionless and still, And as I mounted up the hill, the music in my heart I bore, long after it was heard no more. Let's understand the meaning of difficult words. Maiden means unmarried girl. Then sickle. What is sickle? It's a tool used to cut crops. You can see in the background, the girl is carrying the crops and the sickle in her right hand. The curved image. Yes? I'm showing you another picture of sickle. This is how the sickle looks. You must have seen this tool in the hands of gardeners when they cut grass or when they cut crops. Yes? So this is sickle. Now motionless means without any movement. Mounted means walked or climbed. Bore means carried. So let's understand this last stanza. Understand this stanza very carefully because it is the last stanza. And with this stanza only you will come to know about the ending of the poem. So whatever the theme the maiden sang, whatever the theme, the poet was not able to recognize why the girl was singing the song. The song was related to what? The poet was not able to get the answer of this question. So then in the end he says, whatever the theme may be, the unmarried girl is singing about, as if her song could have no ending. It feels that the song of the girl has no ending at all. I saw her singing at her work. The poet then says that I saw the girl singing at her work and over the sickle bending. She was bending and cutting the crops. She was holding the sickle in her hand. She was bending and cutting the crops. I listened motionless and still. The poet listened the song motionless without any movement and he was standing still. And as I mounted up the hill, the music in my heart I bore. And as I mounted up the hill. Now, just recall, we have studied that this poem is related to the highlands of Scotland. Yes? And so the poet is walking, climbing up the hill. And the music of the girl, the song of the girl, he carried in his heart. As he continued his journey, he carried the song of the girl in his heart. And the last line is, long after it was heard no more. And the poet says that that song of the girl was never heard after that. Till the time the poet wrote this poem, till that time the poet had never heard that beautiful, soothing song after the girl. So let's quickly revise what is there in this fourth stanza. The poet was not able to recognize the theme of the song, and so he says, whatever the theme the maiden is singing about, it feels that the song of the girl has no ending at all. The poet has seen the girl who was singing, doing her work. It means she must be enjoying her work. That's why she is singing. And she was bending, cutting the crops, reaping the crops with the sickle. The poet was standing motionless without any movement. And when he came in his senses, he realized that he was going on his journey. He had to go somewhere and do his work. So he started his journey. He climbed the hill. He carried that song in his heart. And he then, in the last line, he says that he was not able to hear that beautiful song till now, till the time he had written the poem. So this was all there in the poem. Thank you so much for watching the poem, and if you have liked the explanation, you have understood the explanation, kindly click on the thumbs up. And as I told you, if you want to understand this poem in Hindi also, don't forget to subscribe the channel and click on the bell icon so that you may get the notification of the new video when I'll be uploading for its Hindi explanation. Okay? Thank you so much.